Marcus, thank you very much for that introduction, and thank you, I guess it is to Atif in particular, for initiating the invitation for me to be here today. It's a great pleasure to be here in Princeton with all of you. A great pleasure, I must say, also to be with people like Marcus and Atif, whose work I've greatly valued and which is extensively quoted in my book, Between Debt and the Devil. Now, I do have a book out, and whenever you have a book out, your publishers expect you to mention it at all possible opportunities and to provide a set of, I was going to say subtle, but not really subtle, encouragements to go out and buy the book. So in part of what I'm going to do today, I'm going to give you some of the key themes of that book. But I'm also going to try and do a little bit more of the theory that lies behind it, and in particularly some theories about monetary policy and financial stability in the modern economy, by which I mean the economy which has emerged in the last 50 years or so, which I think has some features which have some very specific implications for monetary policy. As Marcus said, I became chairman of the UK Financial Services Authority in autumn 2008. Indeed, very specifically, I became chairman of it on September the 20th, 2008, which was 5 days after the collapse of Lehman Brothers. That's rather like being appointed captain of the Titanic after you've hit the iceberg, but before you've actually sunk. And obviously, I spent autumn 2008 with fellow regulators, fellow central bankers, finance ministries, debating how do we stabilize the financial system? How do we deal with the emergency measures to stop that extraordinary crisis turning into a really, really great depression? We'd sort of done that by early 2009, and we changed our attention to what did we have to do to re-regulate the global system to make it safer so that this didn't happen again. And for 4 years of my life, from 2009 to 2013, I was chairman of the major policy committee of the International Financial Stability Board and integrally involved in all the debates about the re-regulation of the banking system, Basel III capital and liquidity requirements. So I heard just before lunch some criticism of Basel III. There are probably criticisms that I myself would put forward. But I have to say that overall, within the limitations of the difficulty of developing those international standards, I think we did an okay job in the specific sense that I think that today the stability of the financial system itself is much better than it was in 2007, by which I think mean that I think the probability that we will suddenly see the failure of major institutions, which then lead on through a domino effect into worries about other institutions, we have greatly reduced that. But I also became increasingly convinced over the years that in terms of our understanding of fundamentally why 2008 had occurred, and in particular our understanding of why the recovery from 2008 has been so slow and weak across the world, and why 8 years later we still have close to zero interest rates and inflation below target and low growth, I believe that we were simply skimming the surface of that, and that is what my book is about. Why did the crisis occur, but even more deeply, why has recovery been so difficult? And if I had to add, sum up my point of view of why recovery has been so difficult in one chart, it would be this one, which shows, and it's taken from Carmen Reinhart and Ken Rogoff, it shows the growth of private sector credit, company and household credit, as a percent of GDP, not just over the 10 years before 2007, but over a half century. In 1950, across all the advanced economies together, private credit as a percent of GDP was 50%. By 2007, it reaches 170%. And as you can see, it grows pretty much every single year from 1950, from 2007, and at an accelerating pace after about 1990. I think that the issues of the importance of the overall stock of debt in our economies were, for a variety of reasons, inadequately explored by macroeconomics before the crisis. They were well familiar to an earlier generation of economists who had thought about the causes of the Great Depression of the 1930s. And at the start of this lecture, I'd just like to put up, I rather like this quote from a man called Luigi Einaudi. Now, I'd like to just take a show of hands. How many people here know who Luigi Einaudi is? Ah, good, yes, it's somewhat the older people, I think. He was a very fine Italian economist. He was governor of the Banca d'Italia, and he was indeed president of the Italian Republic. And he wrote a lovely little essay, and it is simply called Debts. It's called Debiti. And at the opening lines of that read, I am unable to take seriously people who complain about crisis but who do not talk about debts, whereby debts I mean any obligation whose amount remains fixed or changes little when prices change. And I'm going to suggest that that is a fundamental issue that we have to think about, the impact of debt contracts defined in that way on our economies. What is true to say, however, is that in the years before the crisis, this increase in the level of debt, the level of leverage, rang very few alarm bells in most of modern economics and modern finance. I think you could say that in the finance theorists, the predominant focus of their work was on the danger that there might be too few debt contracts, not too many. So if you were to go back to, for instance, the work by Ross Levine in his Meta Review of the Literature in 2005, he quotes a set of theoretical literature, for instance, Robert Townsend's work, which tells us why we need debt contracts, why you can't get an adequate mobilization of capital to fund industrialization and growth if you rely entirely on equity contracts, because of the well-known problems of costly state verification. When an investor gives money on an equity contract, they are vulnerable to the fact that the entrepreneur can lie about the true return. So we create these fixed term contracts, contracts with fixed contractual features. And there's a lot of work in the economic historians' work about how you wouldn't have got the mobilization of capital in the 19th century industrial revolution in Britain if you hadn't had banks and debt contracts as well as equity contracts. And there is empirical work, for instance, quoted by Ross Levine in that meta-literature review, which says, look, here's India. And it, in 1980, only had debt to GDP of 10%. If it had debt to GDP of 30 or 40%, our econometrics tell us it would have grown faster. So most of the work in the finance literature space was about the danger of having too little debt, and there was very little work on whether there could be too much debt. Meanwhile, I think it's fair to say that if we move down to the other end of the academic corridor to the monetary theorists, the predominant assumption was that the details of the financial system just really weren't very important. And we talked a little bit about that earlier. Michael was talking about it and other people about the idea of the financial system as a veil. As Olivier Blanchard put it in October 2012, we assumed we could ignore much of the details of the financial system, that the details of aggregate bank balance sheets weren't very important, or as Mervyn King put it, the dominant New Keynesian model of monetary economics lacks an account of financial intermediation so that money, credit, and banks play no meaningful role. And we had the debate earlier this morning about the way that DSGE models really don't have a rich or indeed any real account at all of the financial system within it. And that drove us to the point of view that monetary policy did not have to focus on monetary aggregates, defined either by money or credit, but could focus solely on achieving one objective with one instrument: low and stable inflation achieved through the interest rate. That was the pre-crisis orthodoxy. Now, I think what is interesting is that that pre-crisis orthodoxy might have been justified, and indeed the idea that we didn't need to worry about the financial system creating too much debt might have been justified if two things that we tend to say in our textbooks about credit creation and banks, if they were true. I think it is reasonable to say that if you pick up most textbooks and read the area which describes banks and bank lending, they tend to say two things. Banks take deposits of money from savers and lend it to borrowers. And you heard earlier Michael Kumhoff quoting John Vickers, who says that when he attempts to describe what banks really do, he tells his students not to read the textbooks because this is what the textbooks say. And the textbooks also tend to say banks lend money to entrepreneurs stroke businesses, thus allocating funds between alternative investment projects. And that was quite interesting that when Philip Schnabel responded to Michael Kumhoff earlier, and he said, let's think about a simple model of the bank activity, it was lending to an entrepreneur or a business for a capital investment project. The fundamental problem, I think, is that as statements of what banks do in the modern economy, both of those statements are pretty much entirely mythical. They're not correct. Michael has already talked about the fact that banks don't just intermediate existing money, they create credit, money, and purchasing power. Or, more specifically, what they create is credit and purchasing power and some category of bank liability, of which a subset we somewhat arbitrarily label money. But essentially, I think the crucial insight is that banks extend credit, they create purchasing power, they grant purchasing power to somebody by giving them money into their account, and at the end of the day, you have an increase in the bank balance sheet on both the assets and the liability sides, which cannot be destroyed other than by the credits being paid off or written off. Once it is there, it is there until the bank balance sheets shrink. And I have to say, I think this is fundamental. I don't think you can think about this as being, oh, this is another way to model financial frictions, that we could do it in the old model or the new model. I think once you turn around and think about banks lending money in a way that creates credit, money, and purchasing power, it does fundamentally change the way we think about the economy. And what is quite interesting is that that way of thinking about what banks do was absolutely familiar to early 20th century economists such as Knut Wicksell, such as Friedrich von Hayek, such as, to a degree, the Keynes of the treatise on money, even more than the general theory. And then it largely disappears from a lot of formal macroeconomics after about the 50s, 60s, and 70s, in what in my book I call the strange amnesia of modern macroeconomics. Now, but it's also, and I'll come back to this in a minute, I think it's mythical that banks lend money to entrepreneurs and businesses. But let me first of all say that if both of these statements were true, then the pre-crisis monetary theory proposition that we could just focus on hitting a stable inflation target achieved by the interest rate might have been legitimate. And the argument that it might have been legitimate actually goes back to Knut Wicksell. And I think, although sometimes people don't realize the intellectual lineage of it, the basis of inflation targeting is in Knut Wicksell's interest and prices, produced as long ago as 1898. What Wicksell argued was that credit is extended to entrepreneurs, stroke businesses, to fund capital investment. He said, out there in the real economy, there is a marginal productivity of new capital investment, which he called the natural rate of interest. He then said, well, if the policy or market rate is below the natural rate of interest, there is a danger that people will go into malinvestment, too much credit will be extended, and they'll get inflation. But if policy or markets rates are equal to the natural rate, we will get optimal investment and price stability. He then went on to say, well, of course, the natural rate is an unobservable fact, but if you vary the policy rate to ensure price stability, then you know that the policy and market rate must equal the natural rate, because it must be in order to hit price stability. So you end up believing that provided you have an inflation targeting objective and meet low and stable inflation, then you know that whatever the level of leverage in the economy is optimal, because it is funding appropriate investment. But here's the problem. This whole model is wrong. Banks create credit, money, and purchasing power, and therefore it matters hugely to whom they grant that credit, money, and purchasing power. And in the modern economy, the vast majority of credit does not fund new capital investment by entrepreneurs stroke businesses. Just empirically does not. I think we have to think about three conceptually different functions of lending in our economy. Yes, we can have lending which in sense funds investment, whether it be new capital equipment investment, new real estate construction investment, perhaps new training and capital, new training, new human capital. But we also have to realize that quite a lot of credit funds increased consumption. Now, that might be welfare maximizing if you believe that people are therefore able to achieve a more optimal allocation of consumption across their life cycle within a permanent lifetime income constraint, but it has nothing to do whatsoever with the allocation of capital between alternative capital investment projects on which our theory tends to focus. But actually, the majority of credit in modern economies isn't doing either of those top two functions. It is financing the purchase of assets that already exist. I mean, those could be anything. They could be fine wine. They could be Fabergé eggs. They could be existing businesses through the leveraging up of the private equity business and leverage buyouts. But actually, by far the biggest element of it is lending against real estate and lending to buy real estate that already exists. My own calculations looked at in the UK suggest that only about 15% of all bank lending goes to that iconic textbook aim of funding entrepreneurs or businesses for new capital investment. Now, when I put up those figures, people say, ah, yes, but Adair, we know, you know, British people are crazy about buying houses. The rest of the world isn't like that. But actually, there's a wonderful piece of empirical work, which has been supported by the Institute of New Economic Thinking, of which I'm the chair, which has been done by Alan Taylor, Maurice Schulerich, and Oscar Yorda, which has pointed out that this tendency to end up essentially lending money against real estate is found across all advanced economy banking systems. What they've got is a database that goes back to 1870 for 17 major advanced economies, and they work out how much of the total lending of the banking system, or in the USA, the capital market system, is funding real estate. And this is just residential real estate. There's commercial real estate on top of this. And the way to read this chart is I would ignore the volatility in the first half of the 20th century when you have world wars and hyperinflation. Some weird things happen in particular periods. But the big story is actually summed up by Taylor, Schulerich, and Yorda themselves. And it's this. With very few exceptions, the bank's primary business consisted of non-mortgage lending to companies in 1928 or in 1970, as late as 1970. But by 2007, banks in most countries had turned primarily into real estate lenders. The intermediation of household savings for productive investment in the business sector, the standard textbook role of the financial sector, constitutes only a minor share of the business of banking today. So if we build a whole load of models, as we do in our textbooks and in many of our macro papers, which in the first paragraph say, let me assume that the bank lends money to entrepreneurs stroke businesses and allocates capital between alternative capital investment projects, we've started with a paragraph which is going to lead us to wrong conclusions about the macro impact of lending in the real economy. Why does this matter? It matters because banks can create, unless we constrain them through public policy, limitless amounts of credit, money, and purchasing power. But if the main thing they lend money against is existing real estate, and if existing real estate is to a degree inelastic in supply because it is locationally specific, because people all want to live in the nicer part of town and hoteliers want to put their hotel just on the beach rather than a mile away from the beach, or just on the skiing piste rather than a mile away from the skiing piste. If the value of real estate is highly locationally specific and resides as much in the inelastic supply urban land as in the constructed value, then all that will happen when you extend more credit is that the price of the real estate will respond. And the increasing price of the real estate will then induce in the minds of both borrowers and lenders the belief that it would be a good idea to borrow and lend some more money because they expect prices to go up yet more. And it will generate a temporary increase in their net worth, which gives to the borrower some equity on the basis of which to borrow some more money, and which swells the capital base of the banking system and makes it appear that they can lend more money. And these cycles of credit and asset prices are, as Claudio Borio has shown in a series of excellent papers for the Bank for International Settlements, they're not just part of the story of financial instability in the modern economy, they are again and again the whole story. They're the story of what goes wrong in Japan in the upswing of the 1980s and then the downswing of the 1990s. They are the story of what happens in Scandinavia in the upswing of the late 80s and then the downswing of the Scandinavian banking crisis of the early 90s. And they are what goes wrong in the US and in the UK and in Spain and in Ireland in the upswing up to 2008 and the downswing thereafter. I think that we have to understand that in the modern economy, one of the most important drivers of instability is what I call the interface between the fact that banks, unless constrained, can create infinite amounts of credit money and purchasing power, coming up against the inelasticity and the constrained supply of urban land and urban real estate. I think, by the way, that that is inherent. And let me just say one very quick word here. I think it's striking that modern economies are inherently more real estate intensive. This chart is taken straight from Thomas Piketty. Piketty, as I'm sure you all know, has illustrated this remarkable fact of a dramatic cycle in the ratio of wealth to income in a series of what are now advanced economies in Britain, in France, in Germany, in the US and Japan, illustrating that that ratio used to be about 6 or 7 in the 18th and 19th century, fell to about 2 or 3 in the mid-20th century, and is back to 6 or 7. And as many of you will know, Thomas Piketty has set out a complicated set of theories about the relationship of S over G and R greater than G as to why this has occurred. But what Piketty does not himself stress is that if you want to work out where the vast majority of that increase in the wealth-to-income ratio comes from, it comes from one thing, which is the green slice here, which is the rise in the value of urban real estate. And there is also a very fine paper by Maurice Schullerich, which illustrates that of that rise in the value of urban real estate, about 70 or 80% on average is explained not by the constructed value of the real estate, but by the increase in the value of locationally specific urban land. I think there are some fundamental things going on in our economy which are bound to make them more real estate intensive. I think it is inherent that the desire to spend money making sure that you live in the nice part of town or can go to the holiday right on the beach or right on the piste is a high income elasticity category of consumption. There's simply a limit to how many washing machines most of us want to own, or clothes, or food, or lots of other things. Those are typically less than one income elasticity. But the desire to compete with one another, to live in the nicer parts of town, to have the nicer real estate, that is very logically a high income elasticity activity because it's a very strong determinant of one's standard of living, one's quality of life. But that means that on average you will see a rise of real estate values relative to current prices and incomes. But the fact that that becomes obvious to people then makes it obvious that you should try and treat real estate as an asset class, because you want to participate in that rising value. And it's the asset class which is the easiest thing for the banking system to lend money against, because it seems that you don't have to do the careful analysis of the business project of this entrepreneur stroke businesses. You just have to lend against the value of the land. But you put all that together, and essentially, we have an essentially indeterminate price, almost a price without an equilibrium. Overall, therefore, I believe that contrary to an orthodoxy, which has assumed that as long as price stability is achieved, that the level of mix of private sector leverage can be ignored. Something which was based on the idea that the policy rate equaled the natural rate would ensure the optimal credit creation and allocation. Once you have inefficient markets, once you have self-fulfilling expectations, and once you have lending against irreproducible assets, first of all, the policy rate does not equal the market rate because you have an endogenous variation in spreads as assessments of risk change. But crucially, private returns are heterogeneous by sector and unstable over time. There is no one natural rate, which is given by the physical reality of the marginal productivity of capital. The rate which matters is the perceived rate in the borrower's mind. That is actually fundamental to Keynes's marginal efficiency of capital, but I think it really changes one's nature as to whether one can control this unstable system simply by the interest rate. Let me tease out two questions. I'm arguing that banks can create money, credit, and purchasing power, and left to themselves in economies which are more real estate intensive, they will create more and more and more, but then reach a point of crisis and then create less. But why essentially does this growth in leverage matter? And how precisely is it possible without stimulating inflation? Why do I believe that we have a set of problems of instability in our economy which will never be dealt with by an inflation targeting central bank? Because the problems will not show up in advance in an excessive rate of inflation. Let me say a quick thing about those two points. Why does the growth of leverage matter? Well, it matters essentially for the reasons which Atif and Amir Sufi have set out in House of Debt. Once we create too much leverage, we get to a situation where the debt never really goes away in the global economy. It simply moves around. And where we appear to be blocked with the classic policy levers to stimulate nominal demand, either blocked or ineffective or having adverse side effects. What do I mean by the debt doesn't go away, it simply moves around? Well, I think we should have known that this would occur because there was before 2008 a canary in the mine, and the canary was called Japan. So Japan in the 1980s has the biggest ever credit and real estate boom. The amount of lending, credit extended to fund real estate purchase goes up by 2.5 to 3 times in 5 years. The value of real estate goes up 4 or 5 times in central Tokyo in the course of a decade. It reaches a crisis in 1990, confidence pops, asset prices come down. And what you then have is a group of companies, and in Japan's case, it was primarily companies, not households, whereas what Atif and Amir describe in House of Debt is US households, but it's the same process. These companies in Japan feel over-leveraged, and in attempt to get their leverage back under control, they cut investment. And they become determined to restore their balance sheets, whatever the central bank does to the interest rate. They become almost entirely inelastic in the downswing to reductions in interest rate. In that environment, the cuts in investment drive the economy into a recession, tax revenues go down, public expenditures on welfare go up, and the government begins to run a large public deficit. And you can see the figures here in the sector financial surpluses of Japan in the 1990s and 2000s. You've got private non-financial corporates turning from running deficits, borrowing money from the financial system, and going into 20 years where they've either been neutral or attempting to pay money back. That is offset by fiscal deficits, the blue line as the government moves into deficit. The immediate effect of that is positive, because the stimulative effect of the government deficits is offsetting the deflationary effect of the private deleveraging. But with the inevitable consequence, of course, that the government debt just goes up and up and up. So that the debt doesn't go away, it simply moves around the economy. And the story of Japan for the last 25 years is that corporate debt to GDP has slowly come down from 150% to 100%. and that public debt to GDP has gone up from 50 to 250% and still rising. And that pattern, that the debt, once you've got too much of it, doesn't go away. It simply moves around between the private sector and the public sector. That is precisely what has been repeated across the developed economies since 2008. Here you can see the red line is households, the blue line is non-financial corporates. Since the financial crisis, there's been a slight deleveraging of advanced economy households, almost entirely in the US. There has been at least a flattening out of the growth of corporate credit as a percent of GDP, but no actual deleveraging. But that has been more than offset by a relentless increase in public debt. All set out in a wonderful report, the Geneva Report, with the great title, Deleveraging. What deleveraging? Because the net effect at the overall level is the blue line at the top, that developed market total leverage, public and private combined, has simply gone up since 2008. There has been no deleveraging, and there has also been a dramatic up-leveraging of the emerging markets, and that is particularly China. And again, that is not a coincidence. That is a direct result of what happened in 2008. In early 2009, the Chinese authorities were terrified that deleveraging by US households and companies was going to drive reduced demand for their exports and therefore unemployment. And to offset that, they unleashed the biggest credit-fueled construction boom, probably actually even bigger than Japan. Debt doesn't go away. It simply moves around the economies. And in that environment, it appears that all our traditional policy levers are blocked. We originally think we should have funded fiscal deficits, by which I mean debt-financed fiscal deficits funded with the issue of interest-bearing debt. But after a while, we begin to worry, and those deficits undoubtedly have a first-round stimulative effect. And at the G20 meeting in April 2009 in London, there was a general agreement that all the major economies should run increased fiscal deficits, and it helped keep the economies going. But after a while, we begin to worry that the accumulation of debt gives us a problem we're going to have to deal with, so we say we're going to have fiscal consolidation, fiscal austerity. But that could drive the economy into a recession unless the central bankers come along and say, no, that's okay. You, the government, do fiscal consolidation and we'll do ultra-loose monetary policy. We'll do zero interest rates, negative interest rates, QE, and that will offset the impact of fiscal consolidation. But the trouble with those policies is the transmission mechanism through of ultra-loose monetary policy to the real economy is imperfect in an environment where there is already a lot of debt overhang, because already highly leveraged people are not very interest elastic. If it works through higher asset prices and what's called preferred habitat effects, and people, you know, the bond price goes up, so people buy some equities and then businesses invest more. Those are indirect levers and imperfect transition mechanisms, and they also tend to create more inequality. If it works through currency devaluation, well, that can work for one country, but it can't work for the whole world. We can't devalue our currencies versus the other planets. It's a zero-sum game of the whole world. And ultimately, there is an irony that ultra-loose monetary policy can only really get the economy going again if it re-stimulates the very growth of private credit that got us into the mess in the first place. So it seems that once we have too much debt created in the upswing, we end up with a debt overhang which leaves us stuck with a horrible, unavoidable choice. Either we are stuck, as we appear to be at the moment, with sustained low growth and low inflation, and the debt burdens never really decline. Or we have to do big debt write-offs, default restructurings, but those are very difficult to organize on a large enough scale to bring down aggregate debt burdens without that itself depressing the economy. Or we have to erode debt by ultra-low interest rates maintained for many years below the rate of inflation. And that does undoubtedly make existing debts easier to service, but it also creates all sorts of incentives to create new debts. So we appear to be stuck with an unavoidable choice. Now, That clearly raises a question about what do we do about that. And part of my book about what do you do about that is making the radical suggestion, the taboo suggestion, that there are some circumstances in which the best answer to this is Milton Friedman's helicopter money, money-financed deficits, the central bank purchase, and the permanent write-off of government debt. And that is the devil in the title of my book, and that is one element of radicalism of it. But I'm not actually going to talk about that argument today. I want to concentrate entirely today on the other public policy question, which my analysis suggests, which is, well, if too much private debt, once it's built up, leaves us with this unenviable choice, what should we do to stop getting there in the first place? What are the policies that we need to pursue in order not to overcreate a private debt in the upswing of the cycle? And that's the other bit of my book, and I'm going to concentrate that on here today and therefore make some comments about appropriate monetary and macroprudential policy. But let me, before getting on to those policy prescriptions, answer the other question which I set out earlier, which is, I'm asserting that we can have build-ups of debt, private sector debt, which leave us stuck with a debt overhang, and that that build-up of debt may never, and indeed almost certainly will never, manifest itself in an excess rate of inflation to which an inflation-targeting central bank will feel the need to respond. How is that possible? How do we get this build-up of debt without inflation? The crucial thing, again, is to focus on these different categories of credit creation. And this is one of my most crucial themes. I think we have to think about the different economic function and consequences of different form of credit extension. One way that credit can be extended is in the classic textbook fashion. We lend money to businesses stroke entrepreneurs to finance investment. And there, it probably would be the case that if we were creating too much credit, if the credit cycle was running out of control, that that would tend to show up in inflation to which an inflation-targeting central bank would respond. That's not absolutely certain. There's sections in Hayek's a Monetary Theory and the Trade Cycle where he argues that you can get, you know, these big impacts of malinvestment without an inflationary effect. But on the whole, you'd have thought if the banks are creating enormous amounts of credit which are enabling people to pile huge amounts of money into investment, there will be some sort of inflationary pull-through coming through the economy. But if you actually think about the other two categories of a credit creation, they don't necessarily produce inflation. Now, it might appear that finance for consumption would produce an inflationary impact. We lend money to individuals and they go out and spend money. If there's a lot of that, isn't there inflationary? Well, there would, unless there's an offsetting effect going on in the economy, and the offsetting effect may be a secular rise in inequality. If inequality is on a strong upward path, and if it is the case, as it appears to be, that richer people have a higher marginal propensity to save and a lower marginal propensity to consume than poorer people, then if there were not an increase in credit, we would have, as it were, a secular stagnation effect in which the increasing concentration of income in people with a high marginal propensity to save would produce a deficient growth of nominal demand. But that deficient growth of nominal demand can be offset essentially if the savings of the rich are picked up by the financial system and lent to middle income and lower income earners, thereby offsetting the stagnation of their real wages. And I think that is a reasonable hypothesis of what was going on in America in the decades 1990s and 2000s. It's the hypothesis which Raghuram Rajan set out in the very fine chapter of his book, Fault Lines, the chapter which is called Let Them Eat Credit. So I think with consumption finance, you can have a very significant increase in the total level of leverage without that producing inflation if you've got an offsetting effect like rising inequality as well. But, as I said earlier, by far the biggest quantity of credit is lending against existing assets. And the crucial point I want to make is that that has no necessary impact or no direct impact on nominal demand, which then produces inflation to which an inflation-targeting central bank responds. When, as per Michael's model earlier, a bank lends money to somebody to buy a house which already exists from someone else, there is no necessary stimulus to nominal demand in the sense of transactions which take are part of nominal GDP. We could just have an increase in credit, money balances, and asset pricing. Now, we know that that might tend to produce some indirect effects through a sort of Tobin's Q effect on the incentive to invest, or a sort of wealth effect on the incentive to spend, but we have no reason to believe that those indirect effects are fully proportional to the amount of credit extended. Therefore, we can have very significant movements in asset price, credit balances, and money balances without that producing an increase in nominal GDP and thus inflation to which an inflation-targeting central bank responds. And here, indeed, are the figures for the UK from 2000 to 2007. Mortgage credit goes up 97%. Household deposits in banks go up 79%. Gross housing wealth goes up 105%, and nominal GDP goes up at 44%, which is a growth rate per annum of about 4.5% per annum, which to the central bank just looked absolutely perfect, completely compatible with a low but stable rate of inflation of about 2%, and with real growth at about 2-2.5%, in line with the productive potential of the economy. So there is nothing about a credit and asset price bubble focused on existing markets which will produce a response to which an inflation targeting central bank needs to respond. I think, therefore, we have to have an analysis that breaks down credit, and we think about credit in terms of the different functions which it is performing. And there's some fine analysis in a book by a man called Richard Werner, which in 1980s and 90s Japan breaks down the bank lending between lending to the real estate sector and lending to what looked to be like actual nominal GDP transactions. And what Richard is able to illustrate is that once you've broken down the increase of credit into those two categories, there is a pretty good correlation between credit extended against real estate and the prices of real estate, and there is a separate correlation between credit extended to finance nominal GDP transactions and nominal GDP. This is the first versus real estate, and this is the second versus nominal GDP transactions. What this suggests to me is that we need to have a sort of quantity theory of disaggregated credit. I think the monetarist idea that there is some sort of stable relationship between the change of the money stock and the change of money income, with the velocity of circulation stable, is both theoretically confused, it was bound not to be the case, and is empirically wrong. But we must tend to have some relationship between the amount of credit extended for real estate and the price of real estate, and some sort of broad relationship between the amount of credit extended not for real estate to finance GDP transactions and nominal GDP. As a result, if the change in the money stock must bear some relationship to the total credit, now I do just want to say this really ought to say the change in bank liabilities. And I return to my point that there's a great quote from Benjamin Friedman that the economist profession's fixation with money, meaning various arbitrarily defined subsets of the liability side of the bank balance sheet, is a half-century-long diversion which has served our profession ill. I absolutely agree with that. So when I say the change in money, I really mean the change of all bank liabilities. That will almost certainly tend to be higher on average over time than nominal GDP, because it is matched by some credit which goes into nominal GDP and some which don't. As a result, the idea that there was anything enigmatic or difficult to understand about declining velocity of money circulation is just absurd. You will get declining velocity of money circulation if you have rising leverage, and rising leverage clearly takes a variety of forms, some of which have no direct impact on nominal GDP. So let me finish with, what does this mean for public policy? Three slides. Philosophically, we have to understand that monetary aggregates matter, that the total size of bank balance sheets matter, but they matter for a completely different reason than monetarists assume. It is not the case that excessive money growth or that excessive bank liability growth more generally is a robust forward indicator of inflation. Empirically, it is not, and theoretically, we should not expect it to be. But it is the case that excessive credit growth and the level of credit achieved, i.e. the total level already achieved, can be forward indicators of crisis, debt overhang, post-crisis depression and deflation. And crucially also, the mix of debt by categories matters. Whether this debt being created is to finance investment, whether that's real estate investment or other, whether it is financing consumption, whether it is financing the purchase of existing scarce supply assets, that will have a totally different impact on the evolution of macroeconomic instability. From which it follows that monetary policy, or more generally macroeconomic demand management and financial stability policy, cannot be simply focused on one objective and one instrument. We cannot simply have low and stable inflation as the sole objective, because credit and asset price cycles and rising leverage can produce macroeconomic instability while never producing excess inflation. It just won't show up in the signal to which an inflation-targeting central bank responds. And the interest rate tool is insufficient. Now, this second point you could disagree with. If we had here Bill White, formerly of the BIS, he would agree with me on the first of these, but tend to disagree with this one. He said, yes, it's absolutely clear we shouldn't have just been focused on inflation. We should have been paying attention to the relentless rise in leverage. But he would say the primary tool that we should have used against that would be higher interest rates. That what we ought to have been doing in 2002 and 3 is setting interest rates higher than justified by the inflation rate alone in order to slow down the credit and asset price cycle. The reason why I don't believe that that works is I believe the interest rate elasticity of demand for credit varies by sector. And what I mean by that is that when there is a credit and asset price going on in real estate, and when people have internalized the belief that real estate prices are going to go up at 10 or 15% per annum, then increasing the policy interest rate from 4 to 4.5% is not going to slow down that real estate boom, and increasing the policy interest rate from 4 to 8% is going to do serious harm to other bits of the economy before it slows down the real estate boom. And I would say that a test of this is the policy of the Riksbank from 2011 to 2013, when they attempted to slow down a Stockholm credit and real estate boom by increasing the interest rate against the tendency of the central banks. It had almost no effect whatsoever on the credit and real estate boom which was going on in Stockholm, but it drove the Swedish economy into a very significant slowdown. And what is going on there in fundamental theory terms is that, contrary to Wicksell, there is not a given natural rate of interest common at the margin across the economy, which is physically defined by the physical marginal productivity of capital. What there is a set of different expectations of returns which are heterogeneous by sector of the economy and volatile over time. All of which says to me that we need other policy objectives and tools. We need to seek not only to have low and stable inflation, which I think is necessary but not sufficient, but we need to constrain both the pace of growth and the level of private sector leverage. And we need to have a point of view on private sector leverage by sector. We need to offset the naturally arising bias in the system towards real estate lending. The tools that I suggest out of this, come from this, are much higher bank capital requirements, much higher counter-cyclical bank capital requirements, increasing the capital risk weights for real estate lending above those which advanced IRB systems would suggest. I think there is a fundamental problem here of an externality I think that seen from a private point of view, lending against real estate not only will look as if it is the least risky thing, but from a private point of view is the least risky thing, but that the aggregate of all the real estate lending of all the banks put together has a social externality effect, which means we cannot leave the setting of risk weights for capital for lending against different sectors entirely to private modelling approaches. I also think we need loan-to-income constraints on borrowers, loan-to-value constraints, direct constraints on borrowing. And I also suggest that since we have these textbooks that suggest that all banks lend money to entrepreneurs and businesses to fund capital investment, well, maybe we should license a special category of bank which is actually only allowed to do what all our textbooks say all banks are doing in the first place. So I end up with a fairly radical set of proposals. And then one final point I wanted to put up. Should the answer be not my measures, which are all leaning against the adverse effects of too much debt creation, but should they be what Atif and Amir have suggested, which is we've got to change the contracts, and we've got to change the contracts to make them more equity-like, not debt-like. I'm sympathetic to that point of view, but Luigi Einaudi, in the rest of his lovely little article, says it's absolutely clear to any economist who've thought about it that if we could design an economy in which the only contracts were equity contracts, why would there ever be crisis? The system would move much more smoothly. But he then says the reasons why there are debt contracts are rooted in human psychology. People like the certainty. They just don't like these equity contracts. And that, why the final point I therefore lead to leave is, I think this issue of what is the role of debt contracts in our economy, how many we need them, whether we can get away from the strong psychological tendency of people to want the apparent certainty of debt contracts is a very important issue, and again, one which is underexplored by most modern economics. Thank you.
So let's open up for Q&As.
Yeah, Adair, thank you very much. I find myself in the strange situation where I agree with your conclusions, but maybe you have some questions on how you get there. And the emphasis on credit, in my view, raises maybe two questions. The first one is on the transmission mechanism, where money doesn't play any role, the demand for money doesn't play any role, velocity of money doesn't play any role. And so there's a sort of direct link between credit and demand. I wonder whether this is elaborate, deliberate or not, and for me it raises a couple of questions. The demand for financial assets and the way this demand is allocated through different financial and monetary assets, it does matter in the monetary transmission mechanism. At least I would like to ask the question. And the second question is about the explanation of the situation. Part of the theories we have right now to explain the situation do not so much insist on the liability side of the economy, the credit, but on the asset side, the insufficient investment. I wanted to ask you about that, and what do you think? And to summarize my two questions in one phenomenon, in aggregate, the corporates in advanced economy over the last 4 or 5 years, in aggregate, they've borrowed heavily and kept the proceeds of this borrowing in cash. So that, in my view, shows that the demand for money has some importance, and that maybe part of the situation may be explained by the asset side of the economy, not the liability side, and I wanted you to comment on that.
Should we take a couple of questions?
Yep. Let's combine a number of questions, given the time constraints we're facing. Alan?
You didn't mention, maybe just because you didn't have enough time, two policy changes that might ameliorate the problems that you were pointing to. One is the deductibility of mortgage interest, which most of us here in America think has boosted the demand for housing, which means the demand for land quite a bit. And the second So that's familiar. The second is unfamiliar, but I can remember arguing against this for years for many people outside the macroeconomic fraternity suggesting it. Suppose the central bank's inflation target included residential land, or land in general, with a significant weight. We always dismiss that. That's a relative price, and that's not what we mean by inflation. Suppose you change the inflation target to give a significant weight to that.
I deal with those two? Jean-Pierre, very good question. So my point of view about where money comes into this story would be as follows. I think, and Michael said it as well earlier, Michael Kumhoff, that you have to think about the granting of credit as it were, the active motive part of this process. But clearly there then have to be some equilibrium conditions in relation to the willingness to hold money. So to my mind, the granting of credit creates within the banking system in total an increase in the asset side of the banking system, more credit, and an increase in the liability side of the banking system. On the very first moment, that increase on the liability side is clearly transactions money, but that can then be reallocated. So I think of the process as fundamentally actively driven by the granting of credit, which has given somebody purchasing power, and then the crucial issue of who gets that purchasing power. There then has to be, that having occurred, the liability side of the banking system cannot shrink unless the asset side shrinks. And people sometimes get confused about this. They say, well, what happens if somebody takes their money and buys a bond? The answer, if they take their money and they buy a bond, the money's in another account. It's still on the liability side of the banking system. The process of trying to buy another asset, like a bond, cannot make the liability of the banking system go away. The liability of the banking system can only go away when the credit goes away, either because it is repaid or because it defaults and is written off. However, there still has to be an equilibrium pattern of prices, which leaves people, you know, in an equilibrium relative, ready to hold the different categories of bank liability and those things which are non-bank liabilities, such as bonds or, you know, or equities. However, I think that equilibrium that has to exist is incredibly ill-defined by our textbooks, which still tend to talk about an equilibrium interest rate between money, which is, you know, assumed to be non-interest bearing, and bonds, which are assumed to be interest bearing. And I mean, this hasn't been true. I mean, even Keynes in the treatise on money realizes this isn't true and realizes that most money is actually interest bearing. And actually, at the moment, I mean, at the moment we're in such weird interest rates that who knows where we really are. But back in 2000, and you know, there have been times where the interest rate on retail deposits is higher than the interest rate on bonds. This idea that there's a sort of thing called money that you have to hold and that you have to have some great liquidity transaction value from it to compensate for the fact that you're not getting interest on that while you are getting interest on bonds. It's just not true. I mean, you know, I don't get interest on any money at the moment, but before the crisis, all the money I had was earning an interest rate because I could do the most trivial little transfers at the last moment from an interest-bearing account to a transactions account to actually have transactions money. So there has to exist, the motive force is the creation of credit. The credit creates bank liabilities which in aggregate are cannot be got rid of until the credit goes away. Within that, there are a set of categories of liabilities, some of it which we somewhat arbitrarily call money, but most money is interest-bearing. There has to exist an equilibrium set of relationships so that people are willing to hold this. But within all of that, I have to say that I think the idea to pin our economic theories on a thing called the demand for transactions money is a bit of a red herring, which I don't think has helped us think straight. Investment, I think, is a very interesting one, Jean-Pierre, and I think it gets to the overlap between my ideas and the secular stagnation ideas, or at least my book actually addresses the the issue, is our fundamental problem a debt overhang as per Ken Rogoff or a secular stagnation as per Larry Summers? And I actually think you can have a theory, and I argue that it's both. I think there may be some long-term underlying secular tendencies driven by the role of information and communications technology, which are actually reducing the required investment needs of many areas of business. I think there are many areas of business which, because of the collapsing cost of ICT, simply don't have to invest all that much. And we see this in IMF figures, where the relative cost of capital goods is down by something like 25% to 30% versus current goods and services. That may mean that one of the reasons why a lot of these businesses are borrowing money and simply buying back stocks is actually they don't have all that much investment needs, because these computers, they're just getting cheaper and cheaper in a way that, you know, the factory of the 1950s didn't. What then may happen is that that may produce a change in the balance of ex-ante savings and ex-ante investment, which lies behind the fall in the long-term real interest rate, which was well underway even before the crisis of 2007. And that, producing very low real interest rates, may then increase the incentives for the build-up of debt against existing assets and real estate assets, which then multiplies the debt overhang effect. So I think there is a sort of combined theory which puts together, as it were, the Summers and the Rogoff analysis here. Alan, on the issue of tax, I completely agree. I mean, my point of view is I think that even if we had a completely neutral tax system, I think there are some inherent tendencies within the nature of debt contracts, inefficient markets, local thinking, failure to think at all times about the full probability distribution of returns to debt contracts, et cetera, which would tend to overproduce debt in the economy. And I think we've taken that problem and that potential fire and turned up with a can of gasoline and chucked it on top with our tax favoritism to debt. And that therefore, you know, broadly speaking, both in the residential mortgage area, but also as much as possible in the corporate area, we ought to be trying to reduce the tax favoritism to debt. Sorry, what was the other question, Alan? Into the inflation target. Yeah, I mean, I think we should, I don't know whether, I'm a little bit wary of solutions that try and reduce things to a rule. So, you know, I changed the target. I certainly think that central banks ought to look at both the current goods and services inflation rate and what is happening to asset prices, in particular if those asset prices are being driven by credit booms. But I think if you put it into the inflation index, you're then more likely to fall into the belief that you can entirely offset these booms by just moving the inflation rate, and I don't think the interest rate, and I don't think you do. So I'd be a little bit cautious of saying the magic trick here is if we just bring the asset prices into the inflation index and proceed as before, because as I say, I think there's a heterogeneity of elasticity of response to interest rates across different sectors of the economy, and therefore I do think we should have a multiplicity of levers. So I think it then becomes a bit notional whether you formally bring asset prices into the inflation index or you're going to say you're going to look at both.
Last night we heard Peter talking about the turmoil and the tension about the Fed and representativeness. I look at your framework, and if I accept it with multiple targets, multiple instruments, in a period of structural flux, how does the central bank defend itself? And how does it get accounted for having done a good job or a bad job?
Jacob?
Very good.
Hi, I'm curious about the policy implications that you made, particularly when you're when you speak about much higher countercyclical capital requirements and bank capital requirements, what are the trade-offs in determining what that much higher place actually is, and how does that decision get made?
Yep, very good.
I had a question about what is a modern economy. So it seemed like there were a lot of like very specific links in the reasoning here. So for instance, one of them was that the response of housing to interest rates is inelastic. And is that always true in the U.S.? It seems like there was a lot of residential investment that was set off in the desert. That's my question.
Yep, okay, fine.
In 2008, responded ahead of some of your suggestions, because we find that real estate lending by commercial banks has really shifted downward and has become much more restrictive. And particularly in residential mortgages, if it wasn't for Fannie, Freddie, and Federal Home Loan Bank, you would find even more restriction.
Given the bubble and the lost decades in Japan, what's your intuition for how much real GDP per working age person grew in Japan from, say, 1980? Just a guess.
From 1980 to 1990?
Well, 1980 till today, to include the boom, because, of course, the cost was the lost decades, but the boom also rose GDP. So per working age person.
Final chance for a final question. Otherwise, we close the question.
You mentioned getting rid of the, I think you said, pouring gasoline on the problem of double taxation of equity or the preferential treatment of debt. Have you given any thought to the idea that you might use the relative taxation of debt and equity to dynamically deal with excess leverage when it begins to emerge in the economy?
Okay. Rob's question, it's a sort of politicization question, and I'll tell you an interesting little story on this. Post the crisis in the UK, we now have a thing called the Financial Policy Committee of the Bank of England, and I was on it for 2 years, from 2011 to 2013. And it is our macroprudential policy committee alongside the Monetary Policy Committee. The Monetary Policy Committee pulls the interest rate lever, the Financial Policy Committee, with an overlap of about five of the same people, the governor and the deputy governors, but with different people as well, pulls the macro prudential levers, such as countercyclical capital, etc. When we were debating back in 2010 what powers, 2011 I guess it was, the legislation should give to the Financial Policy Committee, there was a I and Mervyn King had we weren't in agreement. I said, we've got to have control over loan-to-value levers. And Mervyn said, no, that will politicize the bank. We cannot be in a position where the bank is the authority to say we are going to, you know, impose a loan-to-value ratio of a maximum of 80%, because, you know, the tabloid newspapers will come up with a story of poor Mr. and Mrs. Smith of, you know, Norwich, who were about to buy the house to their dreams for their children so that they could go to the school, and, you know, the nasty Bank of England had prevented them borrowing the money that they needed, and that we mustn't politicize it. Now, I argued, look, these decisions to slow down these booms, you know, they have an impact whether you're open about it or not. Because, you know, if we decide to do it not through an open loan to value, but through, for instance, an adjustment to the risk weights for real estate lending, somewhere we are going to deny at the margin. There must be some Mr. and Mrs. Smith, you know, who don't get a loan or get a smaller loan than they otherwise would, because unless there is such a person, none of your instruments have had an effect, and we should be more open about it. Now, eventually, we were given the loan-to-value limits. The FBC has been very cautious about them. In the UK, however, we have managed to create a consensus that that is the way to do it, that a trusted body, including insiders within the Bank of England and the regulatory authority, with some outside experts, is the authority which is going to have to say, yes, we are going to tighten the LTV limits or the LTI limits or the countercyclical capital, and here's why. Now, it's going to be an interesting bit of politics to see how that works if we are at some future stage in the upswing of an exuberant cycle, and if they pull those levers in a strong fashion, is there a strong, you know, pushback from politics about why you are doing that? But I guess to go to the point of Peter's speech last night, that is no different from any other mechanism of taking away the punch bowl. I mean, that basic idea that you're giving to an independent authority the ability to do something which your politicians would be less willing to do in the run-up to an election, you know, is at the core of a role of an independent authority. So I agree it's a problematic problem, but I don't think it's insolvable. On the question about how much capital, etc., I think there's a crucial issue here in economic theory, which I think we're really only at the very early stages of. Essentially, if you go back to that analysis which I quoted, the econometric analysis from Ross Levine and others, and he was quoting other people, it asserted a positive relationship between private credit to GDP and growth or utility or welfare or whatever, productivity, whatever it is we're trying to achieve. My hypothesis is that that is right across some range, but it is wrong to assume that the relationship is linear and limitless. It's almost certainly some sort of inverse U, which reaches a maximum and then comes down. What is interesting is that we are now seeing the emergence of econometric attempts to model where that inverse U lies. So there was a paper by Steve Cicchetti and Denise Karubi, when Steve was still at the BIS, which asserted that there was an inverse U here empirically, and that, as it were, more debt, more financial deepening in the specific form of private credit to GDP is good for growth and productivity up to a certain level, and then bad beyond that level. There is exactly the same inverse U in empirical analysis presented by the OECD in a paper last June. What is interesting is that the turning point was quite radically different between these two papers. And I think what I would say is I'm pretty confident on theory that I've got a theory of why there's an inverse U and why above a certain level, you know, more deepening in the specific form of private credit to GDP can be bad for the economy. I am miles away from confidence as to where that turning point is. And I think we are just at the beginning of getting to grips with that theory. And therefore, in terms of, you know, how strongly you pull these countercyclical capital requirements, at what level of leverage you do it, this is going to be a judgmental process informed by a slowly growing body of empirical theory. It's not something where we have hard and fast rules at the moment. On modern economies and the inelasticity of real estate, the answer is, and I skimmed over this, but it is in the book, there are really two categories of real estate boom, but actually a lot of the booms are conjoint combinations of the two. There are booms which involve the building of lots of actual new real estate, sometimes too much, and sometimes, as in Ireland, producing the absurd situation where Ireland, a population of only 3 million, has about 30,000 houses which it is demolishing and returning to agricultural land. So sometimes you get overbuilding real estate. At other times, you get processes which are simply cycles in the price of existing real estate. And in fact, I think, Atif, in your book, you show a different impact, don't you, between a San Francisco and a sort of a Phoenix, Arizona, where there are some where there are zoning restrictions or naturally arising restrictions where the real estate boom essentially drives a rise in the price of existing real estate, and others where it produces new real estate. They are conjoined in the sense of A rise in the price of central Dublin real estate sends a signal to a property developer to go and buy, build a whole load of houses on the edge of town. But they are imperfect. Mitch, I think there may have been a bit of a shift away. The crucial thing to remember in America is, in the US, is the core of real estate finance comes from the capital markets. And it's why I said when I referred to the Taylor, Shulerich and Yorda data that that is banking data for most of the rest of the world, but it's capital market data for the US. And it has always been the case for many years that the majority of US real estate is coming from the capital markets. And indeed, what you are quite right, what has happened after 2008 is that Fannie and Freddie have ended up with an increasing total share of real estate. But I don't think that's a permanent feature. I think the natural tendency of the banking system to gravitate towards real estate or of a private capital market system to gravitate it is still there. I'm not sure I know how to answer the question on Japan. I don't necessarily think that, as it were, you know, we can take the 1980s boom and set it against the subsequent slow period of growth. By the way, the crucial thing to remember about the 1990s growth is the great Paul Krugman trick question, you know, by how much did the Japanese economy shrink in the 1990s? And people start saying, oh, 2%, 3%. And the answer is it didn't. You know, Japanese GDP per capita has continued to go up even in since 1990. The problem is that I think they just have an unsustainable debt burden, but ones to which I think there are answers. So I'm afraid I don't have a clear answer to that, but I don't think it's the case that, as it were, we can say, you know, these booms are worth it because, you know, we get so much more in the upswing that it covers the downswing. But I'm not certain that that's the case. What? You tell me the answer later, right? Okay. Yeah, but I'm sure you have the mathematical answer, but I don't know whether one offsets the other.
It's 100%, and you'll find it in Claudio Borio's BIS paper in March.
Right, okay. From last March,
yes.
Which is about the problems of deflation.
Yes.
Yep, yep,
yes.
Okay. Yeah, okay, the non-problems of deflation, which I did read, but I'm not entirely convinced by. And the issue of, I think the question on the gasoline and getting a better balance between the taxation and equity debt was essentially, can we do that not only as a static thing, but almost dynamically, over the cycle? That's a good point. I mean, I guess if we think that we're clever enough to move the capital ratios across the cycle, why wouldn't we think that we are clever enough to use debt constraints across the cycle? The only problem is that I think it's easier to use macroprudential tools within an independent authority in a way where you'll move them in one direction and then you'll move them the other. Whereas I think tax system changes tend to be, once you've done them, more difficult to change for a whole load of political reasons. Because once you give benefits, you know, in the downswing, it's more difficult to take it away because it is a politicized process. You know, we cannot hand, as it were, a taxation, you know, controlling mechanism to an independent authority. Therefore, it is politicized. Therefore, I think it's more difficult to use as a tool of sort of macro conjunctural management. That would be my shot, but it's an interesting thought.
Thanks a lot. So we have to stop it here, otherwise we have no time for the book signing. So now is your chance to get the book and with a nice signature. Thanks again.